Hello, Rocket fans. I am working on a new project for the booster this time, for the rocket part of our project, not the space capsule. So far, I've been working with the balut design for the space capsule, where the balut is the drogue parachute that is going to stabilize the space capsule during descent through the atmosphere. And once the space capsule has reached about 4 kilometers altitude, it will basically make sure that the space capsule is oriented in the right way, feet pointing down, head pointing up, and then it will be more safe for the main parachute to be deployed. The same story goes now for the booster, for the rocket part, because we also want to give that a soft landing. And for that we need something a little bit bigger, because where the space capsule weighs about 350 kilos, the booster will weigh about 1.5 tons, metric tons, once it has done its job. So now we need to figure out how to get 1500 kilos of mass down through the atmosphere in a safe way, and getting that oriented in the right way when the main parachute is going to deploy for that one. To do that, we've come to a decision on trying to make a prototype for a new design. The balut is known for its stability at high speeds, at high Mach numbers. It comes at a cost in manufacturing because it's very difficult to make, and it takes up a lot of bulk, a lot of volume when it's packed, and therefore it also weighs more. With the booster, stability is not as important as it is with the space capsule, since there's no person inside of the booster. So therefore, we can look at other designs that are almost as stable, and has less of a bulk and perhaps easier to make here at the sewing machine. When looking up for designs that fit into that picture, we found a design that is called a supersonic X design, and that has many of the same parameters, it behaves very much the same as the balut, though it is a little bit more unstable than the balut is. So a couple of years ago, we made this little model here, and we tested it in the Netherlands at Delft, at there. The results there we got back then were pretty good. So now when it seems as if we're almost done with getting the right design for the balut, for the space capsule, it's certainly time to look at the design for the drogue parachute for the booster. So now we're trying to make the first, hopefully full-size, drogue parachute here. And the idea is, as it looks now, that we want three of these to be deployed at some point during the descent of the booster, and then basically like with the balut, we want those two to deploy the main parachutes for the booster when it's time for that one to land. And hopefully that would mean that we will get the first ever European reusable booster if we are successful in doing this. So that would be a fun thing to achieve if we're able to do that. No matter what, we want to get this booster down as safely as possible, of course. So that is the main concern for this. And secondly, we want to reuse as much as possible after landing. So that is why we are doing this right now. And hopefully, just like the most recent balut that we made, this will be tested later this summer. Our hope is to do it in June at Odense Skydiving Center, like we've done many times before. So if all goes well, June will be a very busy month at Odense Skydiving Center, and we'll get to test at least two designs.
What options do we have of timing the deployment of the booster parachutes, and how do you actually decide on which option you would like to go with?
Well, basically, the important thing to understand is that once we separate the booster, or once we separate the space capsule from the booster, we will have two flying objects, one on top of the other. And because of the safety of the astronaut, we want that distance to be as big as possible, as soon as possible. So the space capsule, we want to fly as high as possible and stay up as long as possible, basically. Whereas the booster, we just want that to go down to Earth as quickly as possible and as safely as possible, of course. So those are the objectives that we want to reach. In order to do that, we have already decided that we want the space capsule to have the balloon deployed at about 75 kilometers, which will keep it stable and oriented in the right way for as long as possible, and break the speed as much as possible, as early as possible. So that's the method to keep that up as long as possible. On the other hand, when we look at the booster, we want that to, as I said, come down as quickly as possible. So one thing is to do absolutely nothing with it, meaning that, as you can see here, we deploy nothing. We just let it drop from space and come down again. When we look at the G-loads here on it, it shows that it will never actually reach a terminal velocity, which is something you would see if it was smaller or lighter or something like that. So it will constantly just decelerate until it reaches its aquabraking point, I would call it.
Yep.
Der kom den op igen.
Vi rykker.
You can also see down here that the speed at landing in this model, again, this is not an accurate model, but it comes pretty close. You see here that it will land at a speed of more than 1,000 kilometers per hour, which is not desirable, since we also will try to use the booster again once more after this flight. So what we can look at is at first this detail here. So since it will never reach its terminal velocity after having reached space, we will, if we would deploy the a drag device in the atmosphere, it will, as you saw on the example before, it will give us a very high load on the drogue parachute. So that is not very desirable. So the question is, how long can we wait with the deployment of the drag device, in this case the drogue parachutes? So we intend to use three drogue parachutes for the booster because it's so big, and we are basically not able to make just one that is big enough in this living room I'm sitting here right now. So we have to make three of those.
What surface area are you looking at?
Each of them, well, the combined surface area will be around 9 square meters, and we are looking at thereby around 3 square meters of drogue parachute. And we expect it to have a drag coefficient of around 0.85, meaning that the size that we've made now, just under 3 square meters per drogue, will be enough to get a speed at around 3 or 4 kilometers altitude where the booster will be slow enough to deploy the main parachute. So that's another criteria that we have, that we want the speed at 3 to 4 kilometers to be low enough for the main parachutes to come out. So since it seems to be not too desirable to release the drogues inside the atmosphere, the question now is how long can we wait for the deployment? And we have two examples of what the G-loads can look like if we say at, for example, 65 kilometers altitude or 75 kilometers altitude. And here at 75 kilometers altitude, you can see it doesn't really change that much in the beginning of the flight on the G-loads. We will have a time from, now this example is without the main parachutes opening up. So we will have a time from apogee to landing on 599 seconds. And if we deploy the parachutes, or the drogue parachutes, 10 kilometers later, we will see a rather quick rise in the G-loads, but really no change here on the time it takes to land. So the separation between the booster and the space capsule will not change that much, but the G-loads will look better if we do it a little earlier, the deployment of the drogue. So right now it looks as if we want to deploy it at about 75 kilometers as well with the booster drogues, as will the balut for the space capsule, but things might change a little bit. But that's the idea right now that we are looking at.
That is all for now. So as always, thank you for watching and supporting. If you don't want to miss any of our future updates, make sure to subscribe and ring the bell so we can see you next time when we get one step closer to space. Copenhagen Suborbitals is a nonprofit all-volunteer project. The reason we are getting so close to reaching space on our speaker rocket is because all of our crowdfunding supporters. If you've been following this project and feel passionate about new ways of exploring space and building rockets, you can help us out by going over to our website, www.copsub.com, and becoming a supporter with a small monthly or one-time donation that helps us pay workshop rent and buy materials. And in return, you get all these insider videos on building a space program which you don't really get anywhere else. So on behalf of everybody at Copenhagen Suborbitals, thank you for your support, and we'll see you next time.